welcome once again as we bring you exciting MCLA lacrosse action. Tonight's game features the number 2 ranked Brigham Young University Cougars versus the number 5 ranked UMD Bulldogs. Hi, I'm Marty Westcott, and welcome once again to the campus of Brigham Young University and Southfield. We have an absolutely gorgeous evening for lacrosse, and the action is going to be hot on the field. We're coming to you live nationally on BYU TV and locally on KBYU TV Channel 11. Join me once again, as always, in the booth is the Hall of Famer, Charlie Friedman. And Charlie, while you're no Nostradamus, you certainly predicted the changes in the polls this week.
I knew it. Nobody else knew Oregon was going to number one, but I knew it. No, that's not true. Oregon is a real good team, and they're deserving of that number one ranking. But everybody behind them is real good, too. There's a cluster of about 10 teams that can really play, and Oregon's going to need to watch out for them come tournament time.
And that's going to make for some exciting lacrosse, as today we bring you number 2 versus number 5. Speaking of the UMD Bulldogs, they are led this year by their goaltender, Jake Launert,
who I think is probably the best player on the team for UMD, and that is a luxury if you're Coach Rob Graff. He is an extremely athletic player, really good outside of the cage, great stick speed, really quick. He's going to be a tough guy for the Cougars to challenge today.
Well, and the UMD is really going to need Launert to stand on his head against the tough attack for BYU, and they're led by junior Mark Davis.
There is nothing that I don't like about Mark Davis's game. He really can shoot, great moves, great field presence, really understands spacing on the field. But the thing I think I like the best is he rides tenaciously. He is a real tough guy when the ball is on the ground at changes of possession.
And speaking of tough guys, BYU's also going to be looking tonight for leadership from senior Jordan Harris.
Captain, All-American, Jordan Harris out of Arapahoe in Denver. He is a great, great player. Really good with his checks, but he has a fantastic handle on his stick. Really good on the clears. They're going to rely on Jordan Harris today.
And the UMD attack's going to have their hands full with Jordan Harris. Joining us once again on the sideline is Jerem Jordan. And Jerem's going to talk to us about some changes in the BYU lineup. Jerem?
That's exactly right. 8 weeks into the season, they feel that it was time to reevaluate and see who was in and who was out. So Ted Farron, they're actually going to move him from midfielder to attack tonight as a freshman. And Marshall Kay is injured, so they've shaken up the starting lineups, as you'll see a little bit later. Also, for Minnesota Duluth, head coach Rob Graff told me BYU is one of the premier programs in the country, and they want to make their program just like the Cougars. They're athletic, skilled, talented, and all of the above, and they'll have a first-hand look tonight. Back to you.
Thanks, Jerem. So we've got a great matchup for you tonight. One of the perennial favorites in the MCLA, BYU, versus one of the up-and-comers, UMD. Stick with us. We're going to be right back with the starting lineups right after this. Hey, and welcome back as we come to you live here at Southfield on the campus of Brigham Young University. We've got a gorgeous evening for lacrosse. Let's take a look at the University of Minnesota Duluth starters. Charlie.
Nelson, Prokop, and Mattoon at the attack. Mattoon is a finisher. Great, great, great shot, great field presence. Look for him to score today. Laria, Klossner, Fleck, and Groom. These guys can get up and down the field. Very fast, very capable group of midfielders. And on the defense, these guys are big. There's some size on this defense. They're really going to try and manhandle the BYU attack. They love to clear with these long poles. Zimbel, Frickman, Nesser, Launert in the cage. Man, I am really looking forward to seeing what he can do in the cage.
So as we look at the Minnesota Stars, there's a good look at Coach Graff. Charlie, we talked to him a little bit. He's from your old neck of the woods.
What a nice guy. Coach Graff from Long Island, Ward Melville program, and great, great guy, and very active in the league. Great, great personality, promoter of the game.
Yeah, we don't actually know his record. I think he's just keeping it a secret because he's so humble. But he's been there for 14 seasons. He's really brought that program along. You can see the BYU starters running out of the field there. We'll take a look here with Glenn McKechnie, the starters for BYU.
That's right. Jerem Wynn returning this year from injury. Mark Davis, the shifty attackman, and Justin Heyer back from his mission. These guys will really try and control the ball today. Tyler Monteith, Josh Austin, Steve Nagley, and Murphy Smith starting out on the long pole and on midfield. We got Jordan Harris, Preston Folger, Britt Cohn, and Christian Kikimoto anchoring the team today in net. These guys are big. They've beefed up over the summer, and they'll be tough on those Minnesota Duluth attackmen today.
And there's a good look at Coach Lamb for BYU in his 13th season with a record of 165-60. Again, very influential with
the growth of lacrosse across the country and in the state of Utah in particular. So we are excited to bring you this matchup here today, which we kind of mentioned in the opening, Charlie, is really a showdown between a perennial favorite and a real young upstart.
Well, Duluth has been playing at that in that second tier level, just one of those teams that's about to break through for a long time. And guess what, guys? They broke through. This is a first-team tier now. The voters understand it by making them number 5 in the rankings. We watched it when they beat Lindenwood. It'd be early in the season, and I thought, that's a nice win for Duluth. And then they came back and beat Cal Poly, which is a really good win for Duluth. And not many coaches, I'm not sure Coach Grath would say losing to CSU by 1 is a good thing. But that surprised me. CSU can play.
Yeah.
And a one goal loss to CSU, man, that's tough. You don't like to have that L on your schedule. But that's hanging with a real good team. And I think Duluth is now in that first tier of teams that you have to consider come tournament time.
So you got the two face-off men now jumping out there for BYU, 24, Neil Watterson. For Duluth, you've got number 8, Ryan Groom. And Watterson has kind of been up and down so far this year in his face-offs. And still fighting for it there in the middle. It looks like that goes to the long pole for Duluth. That was number 38, Craig Brown on the pickup. Prokop, number 2, now settles it for BYU. Going against the freshman, Britton Cohn, number 14. Prokop steps in the box.
Lucky he didn't get a flag. That looked like a push from behind with possession.
And
to
a
me.
Well, yep. Laria going against Murphy Smith. They get over to Mattoon, number 4. And Prokop, number 2, settles it down. Duluth trying to work that ball a little bit. Gets some possession. Closter, number 22, going against the defensive midfielder, Zach Davis, for BYU. Mattoon, number 4, going against the captain, Jordan Harris, number 31. Jordan Harris rolling him to the left. Mattoon going down the left wing, doesn't take the shot. Gets it back up top. Up to number 13, that's Chris Fleck for Minnesota Duluth. And Watterson pushes Fleck out to the left. Fleck down the left wing. And ball ends up back in the top to Pat Struzik, number 12.
Nice pronunciation, Marty.
I'm going to have a tough time today. And Struzik with a shot, goes wide.
Whoa, great looks. Oh, and it was an open cage.
Prokop just went wide on that one. He had an open
shot. I hope these guys came out here taking Duluth seriously. I really do. It's
somebody missed an assignment there.
Oh, no question.
Laria took the shot for Duluth and went wide.
Duluth is here to win. These guys are here to play.
You know, I think it almost helps that they're not a perennial power. I think, a lot of teams in the league, like a Colorado State, like a Brigham Young, have never played this team and don't know anything about them. I think that plays to their advantage quite a bit. You know, you have these guys that are out after each other every year, and now you got this one team in here that nobody knows anything about them.
So Fleck takes a shot. Christian Kikimoto eats that up. And Jordan Harris taking it now the other way for BYU. So in that offensive possession, Duluth with a couple of shots. And now Zach Davis going the other way for BYU, clearing the one-man clearing machine.
Yeah, but that wasn't really a strong effort by Duluth on the clear. They didn't look like they had any intention of stopping Zach Davis there. Zach Davis is a great player. He can run through a lot of people, but they got to give a better effort than that.
And Ted Farron loses the ball. Heyer with a shot.
Great shot by Heyer.
So Ted Farron starting there with the attack, drops the ball. Justin Heyer picks it up, rifles it right by Lonard.
You know, Heyer operating really to his strength right there. He's great in unsettled situations.
You know, this is really hard for the goalie as well. He comes in, ball comes across a little bit low to high. You know, when you're in close, you just got to match the stick, and he hit it. He hit his stick very well. He was able to hide the ball and put it top shelf on him.
Here's a look at the whole sequence. Heyer picking that ball out of the air. Yeah, it's a tough task for Lonard. Looking
Lonard
right into the sun, too.
He went high.
You know, if Duluth is going to contest today, that may have been a save that Lonard could get a little closer to. I'm not saying he should have made it, because that was a point-blank shot. But Lonard is the strength of this team. I mean, there's a lot of good players here. I can tell that right away. But Lonard is the talent lacrosse player of the week. They need a real special game from him today to contest, I think.
I agree. And you know, as a goalie, you want to get out there and make that first save. And as an opposing team, in this case BYU, you want to get in there and make it hard for the goalie to make a first save. That's a very good first shot for BYU. You're really getting Lonard's head.
That's a very good second face-off possession for Duluth.
Groom comes up with it.
Great
gets
pass.
Gets it over to
Great
number
pass.
21, Prokop.
You know, if he'd taken it right there, he could have had it all the way to the rack.
Take that in there, young man. You don't want to pull that out. I know the coach maybe was asking him to pull it out, but there's times to do that, but he had an opportunity.
It looks like he's not very comfortable in his right hand, maybe.
So number two, Prokop gets it up to number 10, Nate Gertz. Gets over to Prokop number 21, Jacob and Jonathan Brothers. And here goes number 31, Middlestat, over to Prokop, number 21. Prokop going down the left side, defended there by Elliot Groh, number 32 for BYU.
Defensive specialist, Elliot Groh.
And they're going to want, Prokop's going to try and, he's got a short stick on the wing, and they're going to try and isolate him on the wing. And Groh, an excellent defender, forces him to the backside. And Duluth really inverting their attackman. And Jordan Harris comes up with that, but they had Mattoon and Prokop up top, and then they brought their two midfielders behind to go against short sticks. And
you know, but Mattoon and Prokop really weren't moving. They've got to make themselves targets. It's so important what you do off the ball. And Duluth is going to have to get great movement off of the ball to contest.
Here goes Elliot Groh, top side to the middle.
Great look.
To
oh, my goodness. Oh, my goodness. Now, those two are good buddies, both freshmen, came in together. That's a couple of guys that know each other real well, just feeling where they are on the field.
You know, that's a real tic-tac-toe play, and if you're BYU, this is exactly what you want to see coming out the gate here. You know, you really want to jump on them early. If you're the, you know, you're the favorite team, you don't want to give the underdog any hope of winning the game, and for BYU to come out this way is huge.
Well, I talking with Coach Lamb a little bit earlier before the game, he talked about how they just needed to get Ted Farron on the field more. And so
well,
they're putting him in attack today.
It was great movement by Farron off of the ball. It's great. Farron found the hole in that defense. It happened to be right in front of the cage. It was a great move.
Duluth throwing this away, coming up with it. Britton Cohen going the other way for BYU. But that was just a sloppy clear on the part of Duluth. And now you've got Hires going to slow it down while BYU gets their offensive midfielders into the game. Ted Farron controlling it. X gets it over to Mark Davis on the left wing. Steve Nagley at the left corner of the box, over to Tyler Monti on the right side. Steps in the box, gets it over to Justin Heyer, number 6. Monti slows it down, looks who's coming on. Josh Austin, number 16. Top outside the box. So BYU settling it down a little bit. Looking to get a little bit more movement in their offense tonight. And Farron going against number 43, Charles Nesser. And there's Austin. Decided to catch it with the back of his stick. So here goes Josh Austin from the top. Going against 33, Z-ball.
Nice move. It's a nice move.
Trying to find Farron, cutting through. Good look, just unable to connect.
It was a very good check sticks. I don't know if the keeper called the check sticks call, but really nice work by the defender there.
Mark Davis defended there by Matt Z-ball, number 33. And so they're going to put Mark Davis up in the top wing and let him go against the long stick up top.
This is exactly what Mark Davis likes to do right here. Draw the defender and take an underhanded
great
shot
move.
Or feed the crease.
Nice little spin move. Mark kind of deceiving out there. He seems slower than he is. And
guys, I think that was an offensive set that we haven't seen yet this year. I think that's a new play that was put in for this team.
There's Farron. Oh, Farron tries to roll dodge, lose the ball. Going against Nesser, number 43. I think we've talked about it before in our previous broadcast, how Farron's really described as a slippery player. Here goes Heyer. They're going to let him go. He's going against number 3, Frickman. And there's Austin with a dodge to the right. Now he's going top side to the middle with the left hand.
And Farron was sitting there on the crease.
Looks like he was halfway between a pass and a shot on that one. He had two defensemen on him and thought about taking the shot, and then the last minute might have thought about passing, and at that point it's a little late.
So Mark Davis going to get Siebel. Heyer going against Frickman. And BYU looking to dodge. Just using their stick skills. Oh, there's Austin up the top. The skip pass from Nagley. Oh, and looks like Davis lost that one in the sun. And this is an advantage BYU has a little bit here for the first quarter, is that sun's going to be in the eyes of Lonner.
No question. And that sun really is just at the wrong angle for the keeper. Probably for about another 5 minutes.
I think it's interesting to watch BYU's attack right now. It seems like each
player... Oh, there's Mark Davis.
They are so tough on that ride.
He just quite can't pick up the ball.
It's a shame. He let the defense recover.
finds Austin, far side of the crease. Austin looking for the crease. Oh, tried to find higher, just couldn't connect. But Charlie, that's what you talked about in the stand-up, how BYU's attack just rides. They're going to get takeaways from them.
Then we'll see it again, but they are tough on the ride. You know who they're going to miss on the ride is Marshall Kay, who is nasty on the ride.
Yeah, they want to get him healthy, though. You know, really no sense in trying to put a guy in when he's had some nagging injuries. They want to get him healthy for down the stretch when they start playing league play. You know, they definitely miss him. But, you know, you'd rather have the guy next month than right now.
They are having trouble on that clear.
Another great example of a hard ride. And here goes BYU the other way. Here's Justin Heyer. Finds Mark Davis sitting in the crease. Boom!
Great shot. It's a great shot.
And Lauder maybe a little shocked, a little shell-shocked early in the game here.
I think that sun is taking its toll on Lauder. I think it's going to be a different story when you get him on the other side of the field. And BYU is capitalizing.
Take another look at this one. You know, Mark Davis does an excellent job of placing the ball low to high off stick. You know, he drops that stick. Lonert's stick falls a little bit. And when you drop your stick as a goalie, you can't make it back up to that far side. There's just no way.
Now, keep in mind that CSU was up 5-1 when something kicked in for UMD.
Well, keep in mind BYU is up on CSU 5-1.
And that's true, too.
So, you know, anything can happen.
Well, I'm sure the Coach Lamb is going to hit on that in the next time break, that a lead doesn't matter. This early in the game, there's plenty of time for UMD or any team to catch up. Well, and you have to keep up the intensity.
That's what I absolutely love about the game of lacrosse. I mean, you are never out of the game until the final whistle blows. I've seen teams come back from 9-goal deficits in the fourth quarter, and you can really never count anybody out, and anybody can beat anybody else on any given day.
Chris Fleck going to the left side. Gets it up top to number 22, Kyle Klossner. That's Pete Nelson, number 19, handling against Preston Folger, number 1. Out of the Bullet School, Maryland. And Folger just pushing him out of his way. Ball's on the ground, Jordan Harris trying to come up with it.
I think Folger might have gotten away with a push from behind there.
Yeah, I think that's two that they've gotten away with there.
And Kikimoto. And there's Neil Watterson now clearing for BYU. Gets it up the field to Mark Davis.
The clear has almost just been too easy for the Cougars.
It has been too easy. You know, it's as if UMD really hasn't figured out what to do in the middle of the field on a change of possession on both their clears and rides right now.
So Heyer controls at the X. Ted Farron now sells it down as BYU gets their offensive midfield units. Their second unit, which they've got some changes out there. Grant Cotterill, number 20, playing on the second unit. Paul Davis, number 7. And Corey Gunderson, who has really played solely at attack, is moved to the midfield.
Not necessarily used to seeing Grant with a short pole in his hands. More used to see him playing long pole, maybe, if my memory serves me.
Yeah.
Well, it's quite a switch for him to head to the offensive side.
I think Coach Lamb likes his aggressiveness. He likes his speed. And maybe he just thinks that putting that shorter pole in his hands with good stick skills can produce something for him.
Well, you might be thinking of his brother, Garrett.
That's probably right.
Yeah. Grant returned missionary, and Garrett, the freshman, both out of Altai.
I apologize to the Cotterills.
And there goes Farron, trying to take it on the wing. Ball ends up in the crease, Lonert, and BYU continues the pressure on the ride.
Plays so tough on the ride.
Here's Heyer, you can see him, he's chasing down Wiedis, number 16. Fleck comes up with it, and goes down the left side, defended there by Gunderson.
Now, how about a big hello out to a gathering of Duluth fans in Minneapolis?
They're at Majors Sports Bar in Roseville, and they've all gathered, alumnus and parents, to watch this game on BYU TV. So welcome to the broadcast. I can hear the big shout out there in Minneapolis from here. So welcome, and good luck.
Congratulations on a great team this year, and drink a Diet Coke for us, folks.
Caffeine-free, please.
I'll take mine leaded.
Here goes Zach Davis the other way. Zach Davis gets it across to Mark Davis. No relation. And Mark Davis finds Tyler Monteith up top. Monteith going against the long pole. Craig Brown for Duluth. And gets up to Heyer. Heyer's going to slow it down as they get substitutions in for the offensive midfield.
You know, the UMD defense seems to have settled in a little bit, huh?
Yeah, that may be a strategy for them as well. I don't know the coach's mind, but it seems like they're not riding very hard. Maybe they want to focus more on settled defense, and they feel the Cougars can beat them better in transition than they can settled.
And here goes Nagley running right by his man. Oh, takes the right hand shot. Nice check.
He's hanging his stick just a little bit.
That was Frickman with the check against Nagley.
Frickman's come up with some gems here early in the first quarter.
And Farron now going against Nesser. And they like Farron from the wing, the attack position. So here goes Farron with a nice roll dodge to the inside. Nesser doesn't give him the top side. Nice defensive position.
Move the ball, Ted.
And here goes Ted Farron dodging through three guys with a left-handed shot. Goes wide.
Hey, you know, Ted's an athletic guy. He's a great player, but there's a lot of other guys on the field. He's going to have to learn to play with everybody, and then his game will elevate.
Well, you know, on the finish here, I think Ted's got the right idea. It's in his left hand, not necessarily comfortable. Shoots low to high. At least he doesn't hit the goalie. You know, as a coach, that's what you like to see, guys aiming for pipe.
That's right. There's Monty. Oh, and it looked like he was going to shoot. Tried to dump it off to Mark Davis there at the end. And higher, they're going to call that a pass. So that's going to go to UMD.
Is it? Yes, it is. And that looked like the right call.
I think at the end, Monty tried to just dump it off to Mark Davis. And so it's a good call. Frickman now gets it up to Nesser. Nesser coming the other way. Farron tracking him down. And there's a big check by Ted Farron. Ball pops out to the middle. Josh Austin lets Nesser go right by him. That was the old Maverick Top Gun move. Put on the brakes and fly right by.
These attackmen are just having their way with the UMD long poles on the clear. Doesn't seem like UMD has very much of an answer for BYU's ride.
Wow.
That was a nice little look and feed there, higher to Nagley. Nagley just couldn't put it away. Now Mark Davis rolling to the inside. Finds the top side, tries to dink it in there, can't get it. Ted Farron tracking down that shot. And Prokop, number 21, and now Nesser. And ends up in Tyler Monti's hands, number 5 for BYU, defended there by Prokop, number 21.
I think BYU needs to capitalize here. This UMD defense has been on the field a long time. They haven't had a possession in quite a while. You need to move the ball quickly and look for a backdoor cutter.
I agree. The UMD defense looks tired. BYU looks fresher. They're capitalizing on the ground balls. This is a time to strike.
So here's Nagley. He's got a short stick on the wing. Looking for his opportunity to dodge. Takes him down to the left. Tries to roll topside, can't get it.
That's going to be playing with a free hand.
And he's held there by the Duluth player. That's Pitzel, number 9.
If you go for the wrap check, and your other hand is not on the stick, you can't use it in any way. And there he is grabbing with both hands, really, and holding the player away from the ball. You can't do that.
It's a good film for offensive linemen. That's not what to do. Josh Austin now down to the right, and
called for the ward.
They're calling him for a ward. So.
Now, if you're UMD here, you got to get this clear and get a possession. There's a minute 22 left in the quarter. You've had the ball down on the offensive end all of two times so far in the game. You got to have this.
And BYU has been riding extremely hard. That's Frickman defended there by Mark Davis, number 13. Davis. Frickman brings it across, goes against Josh Austin, number 16, goes by him.
Great pass.
That was a nice look,
and
but a nice check
by Preston Folger. Nice back check.
Pitzel comes up with it for UMD.
It was tough, but they cleared it.
Oh my goodness,
wow. What a check. What a check.
Jordan Harris, he got beat.
He got the helicopter check. Watch out.
Outside of the net.
I think it's outside.
Inadvertent whistle.
You know, that's a spectacular check, and everybody here likes to see that sort of thing because it's fun to watch. But if you're Coach Lamb right now, you're pulling your hair out
because he got beat.
He got beat. You got one shot at that check. It's a beaut.
That was a great look.
Look at this. They are challenging.
Mattoon gets it up to Wishart, number 17.
Boy, that's another situation where they pulled it out, and I think they should have pressed.
30 seconds left in the quarter. I think they need to hold for the last possession, last shot. Set some sort of a play up here. Look for some sort of momentum going into the second quarter.
So you've got Wizard number 17 going against the short stick, Angelos.
And looks like they got their
there's a check. Pops out of there.
Great check.
BYU having their way in checking the ball today. They're popping that ball right out of their sticks.
Well, you know it's going to be a long game when your attackman can't do anything on
the
people.
Oh, there's a nice pass there by Elliott Grove.
Shoot.
Jeremy Reif with the shot.
You know it's going to be a long day when your attackman can't do anything against the deep holes, and then you get a one-on-one matchup with a short stick, and you still can't do anything.
So. We're going to step aside here for just a minute. At the end of one, we've got BYU leading 3-0. Hey, welcome back. You can see a good shot there. The BYU team getting out of their huddle here at the end of the first quarter, and BYU really dominated. Time of possession. And Minnesota Duluth just didn't have any opportunities, really.
Yeah, I think Duluth blew a quarter there. I don't. Maybe something was off in their game prep. I think they're a very good team. The defense played decent. BYU was scored primarily, and at least two of the goals were in unsettled situations. So their 6-on-6 defense was okay. They just weren't really there that quarter offensively.
Well, I think they're lucky to get out of it with a 3-0 deficit. They're lucky to still be that close in the game. I don't think this is as bad a team or a bad team at all. I think they just didn't have the ball and time of possession on offense.
They're real good on faceoff.
I think we're going to see something out of them in this second quarter.
So Groom comes up with it for Duluth, and
nice
he throws
check.
It away.
Nice check again. Jordan Harris.
Mattoon couldn't handle that.
It's just a simple check. It's just getting your stick in the passing lane, checking on the catch. It's fantastic.
Well, the thing I like about it, Charlie, is a poke check. You know, it's nothing fancy.
UMD up 5-0 on the faceoffs. That's not a stat that Coach Lamb is going to be very happy about it come halftime if it stands at that point.
That's a stat I'm surprised about. This is the best faceoff man since the Turtle at Oregon, and he is a great faceoff man.
Mark Davis coming up with that loose ball, gets it in the box. BYU settles it down. Farron now against Nesser. And higher going against Frickman.
I think the interesting thing about those faceoffs, though, is they haven't translated to time of possession because BYU is playing such hard transition that they just haven't been able to get the ball to their attack on the UMD faceoff man.
If you told me UMD was going to win the faceoffs 5-0 in the first quarter, I would not say BYU is going to be up 3-0.
Definitely not.
So third line middies are in. The Angelos brothers and Jeremy Reif, number 26. Jeremy Reif going down the right side.
Great check. Beautiful check.
Big check there by number 22, Kyle Klossner. And going against Angelos, that would be Ryan. And his brother Bryant, number 19. And Reif out there for the third line for BYU. Now Duluth settles it down. Nelson gets it up to number 13, Chris Fleck. Chris Fleck going down the right side, going against Angelos, number 11.
Now keep in mind that Lonert, a goalie for UMD, does not have the sun in his eyes right now. He's going to have a clear path of sight to the ball.
Klosser, number 22, big midfielder for Duluth. And Angelos just trying to force him down. Lets him go to the top side. Gets it over to Laria. Laria with a big shot, goes way wide.
Yeah, he had all the time in the world there. You know, maybe not a left-handed shot shooter for him, but he just put it very wide of the cage.
Coach Lamb is all the way over to the other coaching box trying to talk to the ref about something. Mattoon, number 4, going against Harris. Mattoon, Harris just right with him.
Nice
inside roll.
Yep. Very nice roll to the inside, but he just fell just at the last second and wasn't able to get a lot of power or accuracy behind his shot.
Kikimoto gets it up to Folger. Folger bringing it up the field. Finds Angelos, number 11. Angelos defended there by number 40, Nick Ethan. Ball's loose. And ball is still loose.
And UMD getting more active at the midline.
Laria coming up with it for UMD. And still has it.
That was some good play in the middle of the field by UMD. More hustle, more desire.
And they just waste another opportunity, throw it away. Ball ends up right in front of Kikimoto, and Harris pops it to him.
Maybe trying to push the ball a little bit there when there was really nothing to be found.
Gets out to Lillenquist, back over to Kikimoto. Now it's up to Folger.
Great pass.
So nice clearing effort here by BYU.
This is the part of the game I think BYU really has been lacking in the last couple years, the accuracy in their passing and the ability to move the ball up the field quickly on successive passes. And that's got to be something that Coach Lamb has been working on hard this year. And he's got to be happy with the way his team's playing on the clear.
Well, Duluth has not even challenged him on the clear. I mean, they've made it quite easy for him to move up the field. So Ted Farron now controls for BYU. He's going against Nesser down on the far left wing. Gets it up to Tyler Monteith. He's going to put it up top to Josh Austin. And Stephen Eagley at the top of the box on the right. And he's going against number 21, Jonathan Prokop.
Lots of movement off the ball. I like that. Oh, great Nagley, job getting your stick in the passing lanes.
Nagley trying to sneak it through there. Nesser able to knock it down.
Solid defense. Solid defense.
And
I like this Duluth defense. They're big. They're very active.
Monteith bumps it out of bounds. So going back to BYU and the defensive midi line of Elliot Groh, Tyler Saving, number 30, and Nathaniel Robinson.
I think the Duluth defensemen so far this game have done a very good job of covering BYU's attackmen one-on-one. There hasn't been, you know, any defenseman so far that's been beaten cleanly, at least not on the ball. They just haven't been playing very well in transition.
There's a nice clear there by Duluth. Trying to get up to the attackman.
Good movement, good movement, good movement. But no shot opportunities.
Nelson slows it down for Duluth. So as a coach, you want to take advantage of opportunities, but they remain with the ball, so they'll take that. Pitzel over to Prokop. Gets it back to Mattoon. Over to Nelson. Top to Hockman. Hockman going across the top. Sweep with the right hand. Gets it to Mattoon. Mattoon going against the long stick midfielder, Sabe. And there's a big shot.
Nice save.
That's Brian Hockman, number 35, with the shot. Kikumoto equal to that one.
That's a moral victory for BYU, too, because, you know, Mark Davis got caught down on defense right there and was able to hold his own against a UMD midfielder who would like nothing else than to take it to the rack.
There's a flag down. That's on Pitzel, number 9, with a hold. It's going to be a 30-second technical.
Yeah, well, Davis was a little sneaky on that hold. Did you see that? Did you catch
him.
That?
Yeah.
There was a clear bait there for which the defensive, which the defenseman took. Backed up into him, he made himself out. Right? Can we say it? He created himself a hold.
He created a hold.
He
so.
Did. That's well, pretty sneaky.
That's a little piece of gamesmanship, and now BYU is going to be man up for 30 seconds. And, you know, again, talking with Coach Lamb, I know they've made a few changes on their man up personnel-wise and in what they're going to run. So we'll see if it's effective for them. You got Devin Tyre, number 45, out there. He's a big left-handed shot.
He's just a big boy.
He is a big boy. He's got a big left-handed shot. And that ball is down there under Laria.
BYU.
That's a tough call.
Oh,
they're calling
BYU.
Withholding.
Wow.
This is, which is why I thought it was a tough call if they were going to call a push. He was
camped out over the ball?
Yeah, he was making it tough. Let's put it that way.
So this game's kind of gone a little stagnant here. I want to see some magic from either team. Both teams are really settling, playing conservative.
Monty tried to sneak it down to Mark Davis on the crease. Gets away from him. Zeeble comes up with it, number 33. He's looking up the field and decides to go to his goalie. And that, I guess maybe he wasn't.
It looked like it to me as well.
Yeah.
Now you got to give credit to the UMD defensemen. They're not necessarily catching the balls that BYU is trying to pass through the middle, but they are having their sticks in the passing lanes. And several of the balls have been knocked down, and those backdoor looks are open, but the ball just can't move through the heart of that defense. They're doing a very good job of keeping their sticks in the passing lanes.
So Nilsson to Mattoon, back to Nelson. Nelson against Folger. Gets it up top to Klossner, the big midfielder, number 22.
He is a big boy.
And he's defended there by an attackman, Justin Heyer. So they're going to try and take advantage of that. Heyer ending up on the defensive end of things.
Great stick. Rick Cohn is really talented. You know, David Garf used to be able to do those kinds of things. Great with a stick.
Good
great
look
pass.
As well.
Great.
Oh, wow.
That is beautiful.
That was Britton Cohn's goal right there.
Absolutely. Give it to Britton Cohn.
Britton Cohn pulls it out of the air, runs it down the field. And then a couple of quick passes, and you've got Ted Farron at the doorstep.
Really, now, Britton Cohn won't even get an assist on that one.
Well, it's like the third pass. You really got to appreciate, though, a defenseman that can come down the field at full bore, be running straight at the goal, and be able to throw a pass on a rope to his left and start that fast break. And BYU just looks very crisp on their man up and fast break and unsettled situations to this point.
So I think that's two goals for Farron tonight. And, boy, that was a nice-looking fast break. And that's how you do it, defenseman, is you bring the ball at the field.
Farron having an immediate impact on the attack. I think I like him a little better at the attack.
Yeah, they've been, you know, talking with Coach Pete Stevenson before the game. He was talking about the idea. They've had this idea for a little while, and they've just kind of been hesitant to pull the trigger on it. But with Marshall being a little bit banged up, they decided to make the move tonight.
Well, I think it's going to pay off. Farron is so good laterally. He has real range in his movement that's very, very good. And that's going to pay off in tight space in the attack.
Paul Davis pacing off for BYU. Coming up with this, number 40, Nick Ethan, the long pole for UMD.
Has BYU won a faceoff? I don't think they have.
Groom, number 8, gets it up to Frickman, number 3. Trying to clear the ball. Frickman goes right
nice
by Sabe.
Nice face dodge.
And Frickman just runs right into Zach Davis.
He's dodging one too many people.
Prokop, number 21, going against Sabe. And he'll look to settle it down. So BYU dominating every aspect of the game except faceoffs.
Boy, think what would be happening right now if BYU were dominating the faceoffs.
UMD may not have the ball ever. So we've got number 10, that's Nate Gertz, settling it down for Duluth. Going over to Max Mittelstadt, number 31. Feeding Prokop, number 21, with a nice left-handed shot. Christian Kikumoto eats it up. Oh, there's
great
a little sneaky shot.
You know, I was just
about to compliment Christian Kikumoto on being ready for that first shot.
And Nelson sneaks it by.
He snuck it between his legs. I know exactly how that feels as a goalie. You know, we're going to see this one again, but you're not – you get that first shot that you're not, you know, don't think is going to happen. And that second one, you know, you got 7 guys in the way.
You don't think
that's
coming.
He puts it between
coming.
His legs. You don't think that at all in the world that attackman is even thinking about shooting. And he just put it on cage. He knew that there was traffic in front of him, knew the goalie wasn't going to be able to see it, and just put it right between his legs.
You know, he loves having that shot on film. That shot, that's going to be on his cell phone. It's going to be everywhere. He's going to be playing that. That's a beautiful shot. What a great creative play. I love it.
So Christian kicking him, you know, he's kicking himself a little bit, but I don't think he's going to worry about that too much. I mean, that's a tough one.
Well, but if you're Minnesota Duluth, you're just happy to be on the board, and that gives you a little bit of momentum, gets you feeling a little bit good about yourselves. And a team like this is very dangerous. If you give them any room, you know, they'll take it.
Wasn't Duluth 5-1 to CSU at the half? Isn't that right?
Yes.
Sounds about right to me. Yeah.
Don't think that they're not capable of coming back and doing the same thing.
And BYU picking up their first ground ball on the faceoff. So, hey, while we're settled down here for just a minute, let's toss it to Jerem Jordan, who's going to give us a little bit of information about Minnesota Duluth.
Yeah, it's in Minnesota, obviously, Duluth is, but it's home to the nation's only freshwater aquarium. Also, they sported an NFL team, actually. From 23 to 27, they went by two names, the Kellys and the Eskimos. Not many people knew that. And it's home to three famous people who were born there. Hockey player Brett Hull, famous musician Bob Dylan, and the movie trailer voice guy Don LaFontaine. Back to you guys.
Hey, thanks, Jerem. That's more information than we ever thought we'd need, but we appreciate that. And I think Charlie remembers that football team when they played in the NFL. I think he watched a few games, so...
Yeah, that was a great team. Nice leather helmets.
So there's Farron now. Oh, finds Paul Davis cutting. A good look. Paul Davis trying to equip that ground ball, does so. And Gunderson in there, number 17. Cottrell. And Paul Davis at second midfield line. And here's Justin Heyer up at the top of the box. Gets it over to Paul Davis.
Boy, this is a young unit on the field right now for the Cougars. Are there any upperclassmen on the field right now?
No, I don't think so. Mark Davis is a junior. And there's a big shot by Heyer.
And Heyer is having one of those games. He seems to explode in some games, and this could be setting up for one. That's his second?
That's his second tonight, yep. That was against Frickman. Just a dodge to the left, comes over the top with the roll.
He did a very good job of working for what we call 7-7, 7 yards out and 7 yards over. He dodged down the left side. His defenseman wasn't giving him anything on that side, so he rolled back to the middle and got the shot off quickly before the slide could get there. That's a beautiful job by him.
You know, it is a bit of a defensive error. When your momentum is pulling you past goal line extended, as a defenseman, let him go that way. He's not going to score behind the goal.
Well, and as you said, Glenn, he was ready to shoot as soon as he made his dodge. And that's, you know, for young players, Yeah, that's what I see a lot of times is they make the dodge, and they're open, but they don't take the shot.
There's going to be a flag down here, it looks like, on BYU. I don't see it. I don't think he had possession. I didn't see any possession.
Possession was real close, but it'll be a 30-second. That should be a push from behind. Yep. So UMD's got a chance to get one back here.
They're going to call a hold. 30-second technical.
I thought, if anything, there was a push there, but...
Certainly with the ball. I never even saw the ball in his stick.
So Duluth man up. And Toon over to Gertz with a big left-handed bouncer. Goes over the cage.
Yeah, if you're BYU, you'll take that shot all day long.
18 yards out. Kikumoto will eat those up. So there's Gertz to Mattoon.
Nice check.
Middlestad ends
good
up with it for Duluth.
Good stick presence.
And
watch
being
out,
pressured
watch
by
out,
two
watch
men.
Out.
Oh, so, okay.
So
that was interesting.
By Coach Graff.
Yeah, called a timeout.
Call.
But it was interesting in a man-down situation where you had two BYU players hounding Middlestad there.
Well, I think they sensed a little bit of blood there. Middlestad didn't look like he had a good handle. He looked a little off-center. And the defense recognized it and pounced.
Yeah. So we're in a timeout. We've got 5:16 left here in the second quarter. BYU up 5-1. Have really dominated time of possession in most of the stats, except for the faceoff, which we've noted. But it's been an entertaining game so far.
Well, I get the sense that UMD is on the cusp of making this thing tight. I think, you know, for a team that's been in that second tier, it's been a quality team, a real good team, but hasn't really been in games with the BYUs, the CSUs, the Michigans, and now they have the team to do it. They got to believe.
Well, we've got a second here. Let's jump back to Jerem Jordan on the sideline talking about attackman Justin Heyer.
That's right, Marty. All BYU student athletes, well, most of them have to deal with going on a mission, kind of getting out of shape and coming back and trying to get back into shape or even better shape than they were before. Justin Heyer is an example of that. 7 weeks before the season begins, he returns from his mission and he's out there doing just fine. In his first two games, well, he scored 5 goals and 1 assist against Arizona in the opener, 3 goals, 1 assist against Arizona State, and currently is first in the conference with now 23 goals, first in points per game and fourth in assists. And today he already has 2 goals and 1 assist, so he's back. Maybe not physically in form, but on the field he's doing just fine. Back to you guys.
Thanks, Jeremy. Maybe he was on the Fui Vakapuna mission program.
Yeah, maybe.
Well, you know, coming from a BYU athletic program, BYU athletically almost feels like a junior college in that you only ever play more than 2 years with your own class because of the mission that so many players go on. They leave after their freshman year and come back, you know, as a sophomore, not having played with anybody that's on the team. And it's a very strange feeling to only play with, you know, these players for 2 years unless they go come in your freshman class with you.
So Duluth, just looking to move the ball. There's Klosser. There's a big shot there by Fleck, number 13.
You know, and still, that's in the range where, you know, if you're BYU, you'll give up that shot and hope that your goalie can make the save and just have confidence in him. That's a 15-yarder.
There's Loria going against Nathaniel Robinson. Robinson, a Hinckley scholar here at BYU, which
is right?
a very prestigious scholarship to get at BYU.
What, so about 20? I think 20 or so. Incoming students every year get that one.
Yep. There's Klossman. Oh, and there's a big shot. Klossner getting it over Kikumoto, closing the gap.
Well, it looks like Kikumoto just guessed low on that one, and Klossman put it high. I didn't see if he threw any kind of a fake.
He just used his body. I mean, he's got a lot of momentum coming through there.
Yep. Yeah. It looks like he almost lost
nice
the handle.
Player.
Because he went,
and Kikumoto guessed low right there, and then he puts it over his shoulder.
Yeah, great shot. You know, he really used his size. He's a nice player. He understands his advantages, and he just muscled his way in tight on Kikumoto.
Well, you know, Kikumoto right now has let the last two in. Not necessarily his fault, but as a goalie, you really need to make that next save to build your confidence back up. Goalies are head cases. You really
this
just
is
need
true.
To make the next save.
They're head cases that we love.
Hey, we'll give you an update for those of you interested in the BYU Xavier score. BYU leads 12-8 early in the game. Oh, and there's a big shot by Monteith. Goes wide. Barron with the backup. And we know you lacrosse enthusiasts are going to stick with us and not jump to CBS and watch the BYU Xavier game.
Maybe it's the commentators that they love.
That could be.
I don't think that's it.
It's Glenn. It's the addition of
it might be Glenn. It could very well be Glenn.
I mean, that's the only reason people tune in these days. It's, you know, they want to see who's new. There goes Nagley to the left. He's going to roll topside. Ball comes out. Still out. Trying to, oh, and he's going to, oh, they called the dive on that one. Tried to pick up a push in the back to no avail. Laria trying to get it upfield. Goes to number 33. That's Zeebolt. Zeebolt's taking it up the right side of the field. Chased there by Heyer. Oh! Heyer took a big check.
UMD has four men back on defense right now, and I don't know if they know
that they can send another one over.
They can send another player.
I don't think they do.
And BYU's going to call a timeout here with 3:16 left in the second quarter. We're going to take a break. You're going to want to come right back as we have a score of 5-2. Stick with us. Hey, welcome back. There's a look at the University of Illinois lacrosse team. They're going to be playing here versus the Cougars tomorrow night, which we will also be broadcasting live nationwide on BYU TV at 7 p.m. Mountain Time, Charlie.
It's too bad that that mohawk that we just saw is going to be underneath the helmet tomorrow night. I like that.
Maybe we need to have our own weekend all-hair team here for the Duluth-BYU-Illinois weekend. Kind of like in the spirit of the all-tournament hair team that they have for the NCAA tournament.
So for anybody interested in the basketball game, the score is now 60-4, so you can pretty much just keep it here and watch lacrosse.
There goes Fleck for Duluth. Mattoon, lob pass over to Laria, number 5. Going against Zach Davis, down to the left. Laria trying to find a throwback pass, and it just nobody there. But Duluth comes up with it. Wishart, number 17. Getting it back to Nelson, number 19.
And Duluth has settled in. 5-2 is not a bad score for them on the road going into the half, especially BYU going up 3-0 in the first 6 minutes of the game.
There's Klossner again.
Oh, Klossner. Nice shot.
Closes the gap.
Using the screen. Watch out. This Duluth team, they don't quit.
Well, I
like these guys.
He turned quickly and got his hands free and got that shot off. He also shot around his defenseman and it looks like threw a couple other people standing in front of the goal. So he gets his hands free right here and decides to shoot. That's what you really need to do if you're a midfielder. You don't want to wait till that slide comes to you. You want to shoot before it comes or pass before it comes. I think he did a very good job of getting his hands free.
And I didn't see any space between that shot and the defender who was on. I think defender was all over him. Yep. It's good defense, but just really good field presence by the shooter.
And Groom coming up with another draw. Still, ball is still loose, but Duluth just doing a tremendous job on the faceoffs. Elliot Groh picking it up for BYU. So BYU actually coming up the ground ball, but Groom again dominating at the draw. And Mark Davis is going to slow it down for the Cougars. Gets it over to Farron. With about 2 minutes left, BYU is going to look to tally one more goal here before the half and increase that lead, put it back up to 3 goals. We'll see if
I think they need one. I think that Duluth has stolen some momentum. They believe they're back in this game. I think it's an important time for BYU to score.
Heyer, a little lob pass up there to Monteith. Finding Negley cutting with a beautiful
great
shot.
What a save. Great save.
Ball's loose on the ground. Pitzel tried to take it up. Prokop loses it. Heyer's coming up with a loose ball. Slowing it down. And ball's on the ground. And Mark Davis steps in the box. Minute 30 left here. BYU is going to look to get another opportunity. And Mark Davis going against Nestor, number 43, rolls to the inside. Tries to force it in there. Fakes it. And we got 2 flags down. Mark Davis still getting
still
hit.
Still fighting.
Let's see what they call here.
You know, this last save was absolutely phenomenal. You know, he's really showing his athleticism here. He just throws his right foot out in front of the, we're going to see it here in a second, just throws his right foot out in front of the ball.
What
just
a
gets
save.
His shoe on it. You know,
my
from in
goodness.
Close, there's not a lot you can do. You know, he had that corner picked out perfectly, and he was just able to get it with his shoe.
That's the nicest save we've seen this year, and we've seen some nice ones. That was tremendous. What an athletic play. Unbelievable.
It's looking like a hockey goalie.
Yeah, no doubt. Probably is a hockey goalie. All those Minnesota guys splitting their time with lacrosse in the ice.
So UMD is going to be man down here. Yeah, actually, looks like they're going to be 2 men down. And they're actually calling a penalty on the goalie as well.
Uh-oh. Uh-oh, you're taking your best player off the field.
So, yes, they are allowed to call penalties on goalies in this league.
And it's going to be a full 1 minute. Two men down.
It looks like you got him right in the helmet with a slash. I didn't see it, but if it's a 2 minute penalty, then that's what it's going to be.
Well, was it a 2 minute penalty? I know it's consecutive 1 minute with the slash and the cross check.
Is it? Are they both on him?
No, there's two players in the box.
And you can't do that when you're two men down. There you go.
So that's Tyer, the freshman. And here's a big shot. Told you, he's got a big left-handed shot.
That's the shot that Tyer wants, and he'll be kicking himself tonight. He'll be watching the replay on that one. He's at 12 yards, 10 yards. He's a left-hander. That's his spot. He needs to stick it.
Austin finding Tyer.
Yeah,
there it goes.
Wow. Can't give it to him twice.
A lot of pace on that shot. A lot of pace.
And that's his spot. They just kind of post him up there on the left-hand side. And
well, he had a lot of separation from the defenders twice.
Yeah. See, that's just big windup.
He has just got so much momentum in his shoulders and in his upper body, twisting around on that shot. He is a big boy.
Well, how tough is it on your backup goalie? You just throw him in the game, no warm up, and he has Tyer 7 feet off of his pipe, throwing at 90 miles an hour.
Well, that's tough on any goalie, not just your backup.
Yeah, poor backup though. He had no warm ups. He's not in the flow of the game at all. It's a tough assignment.
He's got to go take that one. So. Here we go. We've got another faceoff. We got Watterson out there, and then Groom, who has been phenomenal for UMD.
He's a tough guy, and he's just pushing.
Ball is pushing. Just still just
very
right there.
Very physical faceoff, man.
UAU, the ball is still loose, and they're going to call something because there's a big pile of bodies. And they're going to give it to UMD. So very scrappy at the faceoff X. UND comes up with another faceoff. Laria, number 5, going against Zach Davis. Zach Davis pressuring him all the way out to the midfield line.
So 30 seconds left in this half. UMD would love to go into the locker room only down 2 goals and not 3. And
there's Fleck, number 13, going against Corby Bivens, number 21, out of Las Vegas. Nelson drops it, and Preston Folger's all over him.
I don't think they're going to get a shot off. They're going to have to shoot
Wishart just tries to get up to Laria, can't get it to him. Fox going to run out on him, but that's indicative of the first half for UMD. Just unable to convert when they have opportunities. And BYU,
somehow they're only down 3 goals.
Yeah.
They found a way to stay in the game.
They're a tough team. I mean, these guys are scrappy. They're tough. They hit. They want it. And they have some talent. I am not surprised. They've been doing it to teams all season long so far.
Well, and if you're them, you've got nothing to lose. I mean, you've got no reason to go out and play tentatively. You have no reason to go out there and be scared of the other team. You've earned the 5th rank in the nation. You've beat up on some really good teams. You've played some teams close. I don't think they drop in the rankings if they lose today by a few goals. There's nothing that they have, to lose today.
You're going to want to stick with us here as we are going to try and catch Coach Lamb here and interview him a little bit. We've also got Athlete Superstitions with Tony Stoff for a nice halftime piece. And, of course, we're going to come back with our halftime stats. So you're going to want to stick with us through the halftime. I think we've got Coach Lamb. We're going to toss it to Jerem. Jerem?
Thanks, Marty. Coach Lamb, new starting lineup for you. How would you evaluate them offensively in the first half?
Evaluate our guys?
Yes.
Not good, but it's, I guess from a standpoint of what I've asked them to do, it's okay because I've asked them not to turn the ball over. And we've had a couple, but, we wanted to possess the ball and be smart and try to work some new things. And, new people on the field, they got to get comfortable. So I'm okay with it. It's not anything over the top, but it'll work, so.
Now, defensively, you limited their opportunities. They got 3-1 between the legs, a pretty wicked goal there. But how did you limit their opportunities on offense?
We're not trying to do anything special. We're just trying to play smart, and let our goalies see the ball and just keep them at bay. But, the game is the ball bounces funny in this game, and that's a very good team, so they're going to get some. But, I'm okay with where we are, I guess.
And finally, you wanted to wish something.
Yeah, my daughter turned 14 today, so happy birthday, Emily. I love you. Thanks, Jerem.
All right, thanks.
All right,
good luck in the second half.
Thanks, Jeremy. We're going to take a quick break here. You're going to want to come back because we've got some great halftime highlights and stats and some special features. You're not going to want to go away. We'll be right back. Hey, welcome back at halftime. BYU leads the University of Minnesota Duluth 6-3. Everybody's heard about athletes who wear the same socks every game or refuse to wash their lucky underwear. But what do BYU athletes do? Tony Stauffer tells us how superstitious some athletes can get and why their rituals might be a good thing.
Athletes have always been known for their crazy rituals and superstitions, and BYU athletes are no exception.
During warmups, we're given two sports bras, a black one and a white one. I have to wear the white one during warmups and the black one during competitions.
Just warm up a little bit, take my headband, you know, that Nike, that little thing. It's going down all the time. And one of my socks is a little bit shorter than the other one. What else? Just one knee pack.
I have one thing I do before every game. After we line up with the teams and shake hands, I go and I kneel in the crease. I tap my pipes and I pull up pieces of grass out of the ground.
But if you ask these athletes why they need these pregame rituals, they probably couldn't tell you.
I wish I could tell you why I do it, but it's just something I've done.
I don't know. I just started wearing like that a long time ago.
I don't know. Just one of those superstition things, I guess. I don't know. No reason.
According to Coach Lamb, he's seen how some superstitions can get in an athlete's head and affect their play.
I remember there was a player in particular that we had too much time to warm up, and it totally threw his game off. I can remember another instance where somebody didn't have enough time. Coach, I didn't get to do my whole routine. I'm like, well, the game's starting. What do you want me to do? But, you know, I think you're right. Certain players feel like they have to have just the right amount of this, that, and the other, and then they're ready to go.
Though athletes are known for their strange pregame habits and superstitions, an important part of competing is the use of in-game routines that help an athlete maintain a strong mental focus.
One of the things I try to get the athletes to focus on is the routine should be designed to help them get in the right psychological state prior to performing their skill, whatever it is.
As part of his recommended routine, Chamberlain advises the use of key words that help athletes to center and ignore distractions.
I started that last year. Toss it high, hit it deep, and I just repeat that over and over while I bounce the ball and spin it in my hand. I noticed I was able to focus on only my serve and not the score or the crowd or what happened the play before.
I have certain keywords that I tell myself, like on beam, before my front aerial, I have to concentrate on my arms and keeping my chest up, just certain keywords that remind me to stay on the beam.
For Jordan Harris, it's not keywords that keep him going, it's whistling and singing.
I like to whistle to myself sometimes during the games, sing to the opponent every once in a while. Sometimes they'll sing a little love song. If we're handing it to them, they always like to hear a little love song singing in their ears, so that's kind of fun.
Whether it's superstitions, routines, or psyching out the opponent, these rituals keep athletes at their best and in the game. Tony Stauffer, BYU Sports Network.
Hey, thanks, Tony, for that piece. And, you know, we've all played a little bit, and Charlie, I'm sure you had some superstitions, and mine was always to warm up as little as I could because I'd get tired.
Maybe he was talking about
don't
you.
Don't stretch. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, not stretch, and, you know, I didn't want to get tired, so... We're going to take a look here at the halftime stats. Anything stand out to you there, Charlie?
Well, face-offs is really lopsided. Cougs have converted on a man-up. I like that. BYU is clearing awfully well, but so is UMD, especially against that tough BYU ride. They're doing a nice job. BYU with 6 turnovers, that's a lot of turnovers.
I think the shots on goal is pretty even to this point for the amount of possession time that BYU has had. They haven't generated an awful lot of shots on goal, but the score is telling that maybe their shots have been a little bit better and better selected. Whereas, you know, some of the shots that UMD may have been taking are from a little bit farther out, especially on the man down. You really want to see them work to get inside on that man up.
Well, UMD had at least 2 shots that were almost to an open cage, and they just missed the pipes.
Yeah.
And that would change what we're looking at significantly here. Had they converted on those 2, I think they're going to have to cash in on those easy opportunities to really have a chance here today. But BYU's threatened to take this thing out of contention, and UMD won't let them do it.
Hey, we're going to take a quick break here. We're going to be right back with the second half right after this. Hey, welcome back. Here's a look at the crowd. We've got a decent crowd here for a cool night. As the sun went down, the temperature cooled off, but it's been an absolutely beautiful week here. 65 degrees, supposed to be record temperatures this weekend, and going to be great for our next game tomorrow night, which is BYU versus Illinois. So we've got Jerem Jordan on the sideline with some information about the Minnesota Duluth team. Jerem?
That's right. I talked to Coach Graff. He said they will make no adjustments in the second half, even though they're down by three. He likes what they're doing, especially Kyle Klossner's shooting. And it should be noted, BYU on the season went up at halftime undefeated. Back to you.
Thanks, Jerem. And, you know, I guess that's Rob Graff is happy with where they're at, and he's just going to keep with the strategy. So you can see the defense there for UMD getting regrouped.
Well, whenever your coach gives you the green light to shoot the ball, you're going to shoot. So watch for 22 in this half.
And at the faceoff X again, we're going to have Watterson for BYU and Groom for UMD. And Groom has been phenomenal.
Groom's got a low center of gravity. He's just muscling Watterson out in that, at that faceoff X.
He's got that two-handed clamp where he's got both hands over the top of the stick. And we'll see. And Watterson quickly on that one. So that's what we've really seen Watterson do the most of the season, and he just has not been successful today. So steps in the box, gets it up to Farron. And Farron slows it down as they transition the defensive midi line, and the third midfield line is going to come in. Reif, Angelos, and Angelos. So higher, just holds it, gets it up to Jeremy Reif, number 26. And Zach Davis comes off, so Reif gets it back to higher. Higher's going to go to Farron. Farron at X against Nesser. And Mark Davis, defended there by Zeeble, 33. So Ryan Angelos gets it over to Reif. Ryan Angelos defended there by number 10, Nate Gertz. And Angelos just throws it out of bounds, so.
Careless play, very careless.
Looks like his man might have gotten his stick in his grill a little bit there and lifted just a bit on his butt end as he threw that ball, but still, you gotta muscle it through with your shoulders.
You really do. You gotta put more effort into your throw, even if they're on your hands.
Now here's something we haven't seen is Duluth has brought a short stick back, Prokop, to clear the ball.
And a great,
and
great
he gets hounded back there by Farron and Davis. And Prokop just runs over Davis there. In the, Davis set a pick. No call. Angelos. Didn't see him coming. That was number 47, Alex. I'm sorry, Garrett Becker. And Becker knocked it out of Angelos' stick. And now ball going back to the goalie, Lonert. And Nesser handles it for UMD.
And here comes another opportunity for that BYU ride. Just losing their men there.
Pitzel, number 9, going to get Sabe.
Nicely done by UMD.
And Sabe just pokes it right out of his stick.
They still haven't touched the box yet.
So oh, and there's Elliot Groh, a nice over-the-head check, kicks it forward.
And
so that's all Elliot Groh right there.
Call him for failure to advance. Some great play by BYU defense, keeping him out of the box there.
Yeah, it's a bit of a shame they made that call because Groh was starting a fast break.
I didn't quite get why he stopped and turned around and threw it back, but I just didn't hear the whistle. So Groh up to Farron. We're going to hear that combination for years to come.
I believe in UMD right now. I really do. They are coming out to win. They are a tough, tough team. I think BYU may have the edge on the skill level, but UMD plays with a lot of heart.
And here goes Angelos with the shot. Plays
That's
catch with Lonert.
Lonert standing tall there. Give him credit for not dropping his stick at all as Angelos came in. He knew he was going to shoot, and he did a good job of just holding his ground. Angelos has got to place that. He's got to put it high right, low left, anywhere but stick side high.
Lonert also knows that he made a real ill-advised outlet pass on that clear.
Well, and some of that's certainly from the pressure from BYU. They've just been hounding the defenseman and the goalie as they try to clear the ball. And Heyer's going to take it now for BYU.
Well, Lonert's made a few great saves today, but he's also been a little bit uncomfortable out of the cage.
Yeah, I agree.
You expected him to be taking the ball up, to be throwing good passes, and maybe I've seen him fiddle with his stick a bunch today. You know, sometimes as a goalie, that stick can be kind of unpredictable. You get some older mesh in there. It just looks like he's not quite comfortable with his outlets.
And here goes Farron from the corner, basically going against Nesser with a full head of steam. Farron with a nice right-handed shot. Takes a big hit as he takes the shot.
Yeah, he really got rocked. Now, he does love that shot. He loves elevating and going low to high, which is a hard shot to control.
That UMD sideline's going crazy about that hit.
That was a great hit.
You know, that's the kind of thing that'll get you fired up and get you back in the game as well. Just you know, little plays, little momentum turners. You know, they're looking for anything right now to keep them in.
Take a look here at this shot by Farron. You can see big hit right here. Boom.
Great form. Great form. So I just dropped his shoulder. It's tough on lacrosse to hit right. You're always tempted to lift that stick. That cross check is always tempting. But that's a player that understands how to hit. Dropped his shoulder and just drove right through him. It's beautiful. Yeah.
Looks like Farron's going to be okay.
Sometimes you just get the wind knocked out of you a little bit. Looked like he might have taken a shoulder right into the sternum. Looks like he's choking a little bit.
Gasping for breath.
Yeah, it looks like wind. He's nodding his head. I think he's okay.
Now, BYU switched to the Rydell helmets recently for, you know, exactly this type of reason. Guys a couple years ago were getting some serious concussions. And since the switch to the Rydell, which the players seem to be okay with, the concussion rate or the number of concussions for BYU has gone down dramatically in the last 2 years. Coach Lamb is happy about the switch.
He should switch back to the old bricks that we used to wear on our heads.
The Bacharach bucket.
The Bacharach bucket.
Those are great.
That was a helmet.
That was one size fits all. You just had to
lace it up. You never got hurt with those. Here goes Monteith. Going against number 38, Craig Brown. Monteith, the throwback over to Mark Davis. Mark Davis driving there on Zeeble, number 33. Still has the ball. Just wings it toward the goal. Was deflected on its way, and Lauder comes up with an easy save.
And Duluth is just weathering the storm. They're just out there making it a three-goal game, and you never know what can happen.
Now, that's the type of shot that Mark Davis likes to take, but I think that one might have been a little ill-advised. He was not near the cage when he shot it.
That's push with possession number three that the Cougs have gotten away with.
And Kikumoto can't come up with sloppy.
How opportunistic. It's great. Look at this. It's 6-4.
BYU defense making a mistake on that possession. You do not want to flip the goal towards the mouth of your cage. If you flip the ball, you want to be behind. You don't want to tap that ball right there. Your goalie pick it up.
Boy, heads up play by Duluth.
Looks like a hockey game out there.
It does, and these guys are hockey guys. There's no doubt. Look at that. Beautiful.
Jordan Harris calling for an in-the-crease call. He isn't going to get it, but that's the second one they've kind of just rolled in there.
Well, you know, you'll take them any way you can get them if you're the underdog.
Yep.
You'll take them sloppy. You'll take the flicks in front of the cage. You'll take the between the legs looking the other way. You'll take it any way it comes.
And like you said, Charlie, it's 6-4.
Tell me Duluth doesn't deserve to be ranked fifth in the nation. They do. These guys are scrappy.
There goes Watterson. There you go. Watterson seemed to be, maybe he's got it worked out a little bit or figured out Groom because he's owned the last two faceoffs. Here goes Jerem Wynn in at the attack, number 9 for Farron.
Can we use the word journeyman when we talk about Jerem?
Jerem Wynn, has he played nearly every position?
Well, he's played a bunch of positions. He's taken a bunch of years off in between.
And here
he's
to
just
finish
been all
it
over
out.
The place.
Yep. Paul Davis going against Garrett Becker, number 47.
Of course, BYU, no stranger to having journeymen on our team. We got our own Pete Stevenson.
We got the Clint Felstead.
We got Clint Felstead, Tony Capuccio.
Well, it really started with Greg Saunders.
It really did, that's true. Who was a hockey player?
And that pass just a little errant.
And there's Mark Davis with the ride. Opportunistic, trying to come up with it. And BYU just not picking the ball up. And there's the scrappiness of UMD right there. I mean, BYU should have picked that ball up 10 seconds earlier. And Mark Davis throwing it. Does it go out of bounds? Nope, doesn't quite get there, but Heyer picks it up.
BYU looking a little sloppy here.
Well, they're not converting. They have their opportunities, but they're not converting. Now it's BYU that has got to start converting on opportunities, but we're going to be in a tied game going into the fourth quarter. Anything can happen.
Paul Davis with a nice split dodge to the right, finds Corey Gunderson on the crease, tries to turn it, drops it. Ball's on the ground again.
I think if you're Minnesota Duluth, this is exactly the position you want to be in. And if you're BYU, this is exactly the position you don't want to be in.
No
letting this
question.
Team hang around with you.
Here goes Fleck, taking it down the left side of the field, defended there by Paul Davis. Nelson coming up with it against Folger. And Toon finding Kloster.
Great look.
Just couldn't quite handle the ball there.
Flips it up there. Oh, and
look
now it's 6-5.
Look at this.
Scott Wishart.
Look at this. CSU knows something about this.
Scott Wishart puts
I'm
it away.
I'm telling you. They're celebrating at Rosie's right now.
Well, and this is another one of those broken plays. You've got
Mojos.
The ball bouncing around on the ground. You've got, you know, defensive men out of their position going for the ground ball. And UMD has just been able to convert on that's three of those plays now that they've been able to convert on. You know, it's not necessarily anyone's fault on the defense because the ball was on the ground. You know, it's just UMD being scrappy.
Well, UMD has the momentum right now, no question.
8:52 in the third, BYU leads 6-5. Watterson coming up with his third faceoff in a row. Doing an excellent job. He's just taken the last three faceoffs. And BYU's going to look to get their first midfield unit back out on the field. As Watterson and Sabe and Zach Davis come off. Elliot Groh coming off for BYU. And Nagley, Monteith, and Josh Austin, the first midfield line. And the UMD bench getting a little vocal, getting their team psyched.
They are excited down there. They got good reason to be excited. They are in this game, playing hard. It's a lot to like if you're Duluth.
Now Farron going against Nesser. Gets
nice
the ball
check,
checked away.
Nice check.
Frickman comes up with it. Gets it up to Zeebel, number 33.
Here we go.
Mark Davis with the check. And Zeebel gets it across the line.
Nice check again.
Nice check there by Britton Cohn. Coming up with a Steve Nagley.
That's
Nagley,
great
number 27,
control.
Gets it up the field to Josh Austin.
Nice.
BYU has numbers.
Nice fast break.
And Austin decides to slow it down. Now he's going to take it to the middle. Finds Mark Davis cutting to the crease. Big shot!
Oh, big shot. Pretty.
And that all starts with some great stick control from the defense.
Steve
Whenever
Nagley.
You're a defenseman, you know, the ball's coming down, you got to be really, really careful not to get your stick up into the helmet of the opposing player. And Nagley did a very good job of catching stick and not catching helmet. And that started this fast break for BYU.
Take another look here with the big shot there by Mark Davis.
Looks like UMD defenseman flinched a little bit. That's a little uncharacteristic. He should have just followed his shoulder straight through Mark Davis and sent him a message. When you get a shot like that, I'm going to run at you. You don't get a clean shot at my keeper and stay standing.
And the goalie didn't react very well to that ball either. Either Mark Davis hit it or he shot it around somebody because it didn't even look like he moved.
And so what's the call going to be here? Calling a slash on Zach Davis, so BYU is going to be man down. And that was an important goal for BYU. It cut the momentum for Duluth, but now they're going to give him an opportunity with the man up right back.
And you've got one of your key defensive players in the box. You know, Zach Davis is a real utility guy for BYU. They love to have him out there on the man down. They love to have him out there clearing the ball, and putting him in the box is kind of crippling him.
So Mattoon now up top.
Looks like Cougs are playing a box and shut off.
And Nelson over to Prokop. Back to Nelson. Back to Prokop. Gets it up top to Gertz. Mattoon, number four.
Good quick ball movement here.
And they sneak one in. Oh, wow. You got Nelson sneaking on the crease.
Now, if you're on the man-up unit, that's exactly what your coaches tell you to do. Move the ball back and forth, move it around the horn quick, and look for the skip pass. Did a great job of finding the man on the back door.
Take a look here at that goal by Nelson.
Nelson does a great job here of finishing as well. You know, throws a fake low, then goes high. He's got time. A lot of guys in that situation panic. They see, you know, the defenseman coming at him on the slide, and they think they got to get the shot off. He did a very good job of keeping his composure and making Kikumoto go one way with the fake and then putting it over the top.
So Watterson coming up with that draw, gets it to Tyler Sabe. Tyler Sabe gets it up the field to Elliot Groh. And Elliott gets it in the box, thinks about going to the cage, decides to pull it out, gets it to his buddy Ted Farron, and Farron gets it over to Justin Heyer. Third midfield line coming in. Took a look at the man-up opportunities there for each team and the success, 1-2 and 1-3. Heyer driving to the cage.
Great save.
Wasn't challenged, but had very little angle, and Lonert was in great position.
Lonert did a great job of just standing his ground there and staying tall. A lot of goalies, you know, they see a guy streaking in at them, they like to drop their stick, they like to guess low, and he did a great job. There was no angle, no need for him to move. He just stood tall and took the shot.
Smells like some burgers over there. I don't know if anybody else smells that.
It's smelling really good.
Mark Davis going against Frickman, number 3. Mark Davis taking it across the top. Mark Davis going against Frickman. And Davis looking. Bounce shot goes wide. During this clear, we'd like to welcome all of those fans who are joining us from the BYU Xavier NCAA tournament basketball game. And we've got a great game here. BYU 7, UMD 6.
We're glad that you decided to watch a real sport during halftime.
That's right. So Brian Hockman, number 35. Gets it over to Pitzel, number 9. Pitzel going against number 26, Jeremy Reif. Jeremy Reif lets him go over the top. Pitzel. Oh, there's some nice movement there by UMD.
That shot just goes wide. That's one you want back if you're UMD. Ooh. That could tie the game right there.
Chris Hutton tried to get that to Mattoon. Mattoon threw it wide. And we're going to have a timeout here for BYU. Coach Lamb not liking what he sees. We're going to take a break. You can see the elders there enjoying the game. Must be their P-Day, I don't know, but we're going to be right back. Welcome back. There's a good shot of Klossner. He's helped bring this UMD team back into this game when seemingly they were out. It's a one-goal game, 5:18 left here in the third, and momentum really shifted to UMD here in the third quarter.
You know, they need to learn how to not spot teams' leads early on in games.
We see some shots on goal, UMD with 11, BYU with 12. And that just speaks to the closeness of this game. It's been ugly at times, it's been pretty at times, but you know, this is the type of game that's kind of fun to watch. You know, you never know what's gonna happen. Anything could happen at any given moment, and the underdog is right in there.
I'll tell you what, this UMD team scares me. As a BYU fan, this team scares me because they're tough, and they believe, they're tenacious, they keep at it. These guys, I think, are gonna make this thing tight right to the end. Could walk away with it.
And this is the type of team you love to root for. You know, they're just a bunch of hardworking guys out there. No visible superstar on the team. Just a bunch of guys.
And most, if not, you know, a good portion of them from the state of Minnesota. So these are all local products.
Looks to me like these guys have some box experience, too, because they pass really nicely in tight spaces.
There's Fleck going to the outside against Zach Davis. They get it over there to number 17, Wizard. Wizard driving in, drops his stick.
Careful in front of the crease there.
Okay, Murphy Smith coming up with it, doing some fancy stick work.
Yeah, but that's the wrong place to be doing fancy stick work.
Neil Wallace, number 43, transfer from Notre Dame de Moore.
How do you say that, by the way?
I'm not sure, but I hope I'm close.
De Namur.
De Namur,
I think.
Neil Wallace out of
they called Demirner. Who knows?
And Justin Heyer slowing it down. While BYU's transitioning here, let's jump it to Jerem, who's got some information on Coach Graff of UND.
Yes, Rob Graff is actually a lawyer who practices law in Minneapolis. That's 2.5 hours away from Duluth. So how does he manage the part-time job as coach of the lacrosse team? Well, when he can't make it, he emails the assistants. They take care of things. He makes the drives up. He makes sure that he's there on the weekend. And so their toughness really begins with the coach, who is also a Harvard graduate as well. And I can tell by talking to him that he is tough, and he doesn't really care about the fact that they're ranked fifth right now. His main goal is win conference and then focus on winning that first playoff game. Back to you guys.
Thanks, Jerem. And we've got our own attorney here in the booth, you know, Charlie Friedman, BYU law grad. So, you know, he's no slouch.
BYU, Harvard.
Same thing.
Yeah, it's really close.
That's something that you love as well. You know, you got a bunch of guys who are out there playing hard. You got a coach that's sacrificing his time. You know, he's got another full-time job. He's a lawyer. You know, there's really nothing to hate about this team. You got to love their hustle. You love their heart. You love the way they play.
I love their attitude. Coach. I really do. I think he's a fantastic coach. He's very dedicated. He's been a great advocate for MCLA for a long time. Terrific guy.
You see him on the boards quite a bit. He posts on the some of the boards on the MCLA website, and so he's active in the community for sure. And BYU just throws that
sloppy,
one away.
Sloppy. Well, can't do that. Not against this team.
That's looking like the ghosts of past.
No kidding.
Coming back to bite BYU. An uncontested pass going out of bounds. Coach Lamb is not happy about that.
Well, there's a lot of talent on this BYU team. Much better than that pass show.
And there's a big hit there by Harris.
Tough hit.
Siebel just didn't see that one coming.
Tough hit. There's that captain leadership by Jordan Harris we talked about in the standoff.
Well, and if you're Lonnard, you can't throw that pass. You got to be very careful throwing the ball upfield that far that you're going to get your guys hurt.
Heyer was looking to the cage, and there's a Farron. Talk about slippery.
That's quick hands, real quick hands.
How he pulled that stick away and got the shot off.
Yeah, but he's got to finish it, but it was beautiful, just creating space for himself. Farron moves nicely off the ball, I must say. He gets himself into areas where he can convert.
And Cotterill now, the third line midfielder. I'm sorry, second line in there. Cotterill and Gunderson. Paul Davis, number seven. Davis and Farron working the crease a little bit. Justin Heyer getting pushed there by Frickman. Gets up. Just takes the left-handed shot. It goes wide. Backed up nicely there by both Farron and Davis.
And looking at Lonnard's form, the more I look at him, the more he looks like a hockey goalie. You know, he doesn't have the traditional step with the body following. He really kicks his legs out there and swings his stick. He even gets his stick sideways to his body.
Big shot there by Heyer.
It's not the traditional way to play goalie, but, you know, he's made some saves.
Looks like BYU's offense has woken up a little bit, but I don't want to see this one-on-one dodging. I want to see assisted goals, movement off of the ball, playing as a team.
And there's going to be a penalty. They're going to get a cross-check on Nesser. Nesser, number 43, is going to get a minute for a cross-check. BYU's going to have a man-up opportunity. So they're going to give him a minute, and with 1:07 left here in the third, BYU is going to be man up, and Devin Tyre out there on the left wing scored a big man up goal for BYU in the first half.
Let's see if Duluth adjusts to Devin Tyre out there, because he was a real weapon on that man up.
And BYU, I think, was really looking for him on that left wing.
Well, you look at him, you know he's not going to carry the ball. He's a big kid. He is out there for firepower.
And here goes BYU moving, motion into their offense. Monteith gets it over to Austin. Oh, one more pass to Mark Davis. Just can't make it.
Can't convert.
Mark Davis was wide open. I think BYU had just what they wanted and just could not execute.
Well, they clearly had the one-on-one with the keeper set up.
So they're bringing Tyre off for the ride, getting long stick Murphy Smith in there. So,
you know, BYU is leading still, 7-6. But I don't get the sense that they're in control of the game. I get the sense that Duluth is in control of this game.
Loria tries to run up the sideline, gets the ball checked out of his stick, actually just throws it up in the air. BYU still man up.
I don't know that anybody is in control.
Yeah, well, that's true. This one is really up in the air.
Nobody's really taken onus since the first quarter when BYU put up a couple. You know, it just seemed like neither team can really get a grasp on the offense.
Farron on the crease. It's a nice little shot. And Heyer backs it up.
There you see Lonnard's form, especially to the off-stick side. He really seems to kick that left foot out and swing his stick perpendicular to his body, which is not what you teach your goalies to do. But apparently he's having success.
There's a nice head fake there by Davis.
Boy, he is a good keeper. He really is a good keeper.
Mark, you keep that ball out of the net any way you can.
That's exactly right, boy. He really is MVP on this team. I see him as the standout for Duluth.
Absolutely. He's kept a minute, and then they've just been scrappy enough to get shot opportunities. And, you know, you'll take the dink and the dunk and stay with it. So, hey, we're going to be right back. We've got a great game. 7-6 with 1 quarter left to play. Stay with us. Hey, welcome back. There's a good shot of Coach Lamb. Certainly not happy with the I think, the current status, but you know, is looking for his team to step it up here in the fourth quarter.
This Duluth team reminds me of like a Sonoma from about 5 years ago, 4 years ago, where you look down the roster and you say, who's the star? I don't know who the star is, but they're a good team. They play good team ball. They play tough defense. Even a Sonoma this year kind of reminds me of this Duluth team.
Well, Lonner's probably their star. And then where they've really controlled the game, I think, still is at the faceoff. BYU did a better job in the third quarter, but in the first half with Groom controlling the faceoff, anytime you can give him possession, that's going to be a great benefit to the team. So,
you know, Cougars aren't doing themselves any favors on turnovers, too. They are turning the ball over.
Right, 11-4. You can't turn the ball over 11 times and expect to win.
Well, looking at the goals that Duluth has scored today, three of those have been off very unsettled situations. You know, people would call them garbage goals. But when three of those happen in the same game, you can't call it luck anymore. You know, it's just guys out there working hard.
It's opportunistic. You're taking advantage of the opportunities that are presented to you. So.
I agree.
Here's Mark Davis now taking it for BYU at the top, going against Frickman, number three. And BYU is going to look to increase the lead here. Really need, I think, a score for BYU to get the momentum back.
Yeah, they need to. The BYU really needs to reassert themselves.
Gunnarsson gets it over to Cotterill, tries to get
turnover.
It over to Mark Davis, and they throw it out of bounds.
Turnover. It's just sloppy, man. Coach Lamb cannot be happy with that.
And that's, you know, how many is that where they just thrown it out of bounds? I mean, that's got to be at least four or five.
I was complimenting BYU earlier in the game about, you know, the crispness, and really it seems like they've been able to get over that out-of-bounds bug that they had, you know, a year ago, 2 years ago. But, you know, this third and the beginning of the fourth quarter is not bode well for them.
Farron on Nesser.
Well, he's riding him hard.
And BYU tries to come up with it. Frickman against Jordan Harris. Elliot Groh against Fleck.
That's going to be from behind.
Yeah.
With possession.
So BYU is going to be man down for a minute.
And here's your opportunity for UMD.
That's for talking.
No question. Who did it?
So let's see who they're going to call that on, though. It might be on here. It might be on Fleck.
We don't know.
I think that's on Harris again. He's the only one in the box.
So there are two consecutive 30-second penalties, so UMD is going to be man up for a minute. Now, if I understand this correctly, is if they score in the first 30 seconds, then they serve the second 30 seconds on top of it. Is that correct, Ben?
I believe so. I think that if there were two men in the box, then they both release, but since they are back-to-back penalties, he has to serve both of them.
Well, this is a fabulous opportunity for UMD.
And here you see the turnovers that we're talking about. 12-5, BYU just losing the ball here in the second half. And that, again, is not the shot.
And look at Christian Kikumoto getting back there. Who gets possession?
They do give it to UMD, okay. But Kikumoto made a nice effort. The ball just got deflected and bounced out of bounds.
And I don't know if that's the shot they're working for, but if that is, you know, BYU will take it. They'll let him shoot it from out there all day long.
Nelson to Mittelstadt. Matoon.
Great
look. Finds Nelson.
Great
nice save, by Kikumoto.
What a save.
And there's a loose ball push. So UMD squanders a great opportunity there.
Well, not yet. They still got a ride coming.
You put the ball in the hands of the trusty Zach Davis.
Still has it. Gets tripped. Gets slashed. Still running down the field.
And that's the type of stuff that Coach
finds
Lamb
Murphy
loves
Smith
about Zach Davis. You know, he just doesn't give the ball up. You know, other coaches ask where he found number two. And he's just the right guy for the right job.
He was just up the street at Orem High.
Yeah, you know.
You know, and Zach Davis came out of Orem when the program was still very young. He's just a very athletic guy that loves the game, taught himself how to play it.
Yeah, he really did. He's been kind of injury prone. So, he had some ankle problems, but, you know, recently he's been very healthy, and he's been a contributor for the last 2 years on the team.
So BYU works off this penalty, and they're looking to get their offensive set in the second midfield line of Gunnarsson, Davis, and Grant Cotterill. Look to work it for BYU. So BYU up 7-6, 12:45 left in the game. And Justin Heyer gets it up to Gunderson, going against Laria.
And it has been a while since BYU scored.
Paul Davis, defended there by Gertz, number 10. Davis splits it to the middle, big shot. Ball bounces over the top. Ted Farron backs it up for BYU. Now Ted Farron's going against Nesser, finds Gunderson cutting to the cage and cannot connect.
That's gonna be a push from behind.
And they're gonna call a loose ball push. That's gonna go to Minnesota Duluth. Mattoon gets pushed over by Jordan Harris.
Harris there just trying to box him out, but you know, got him a little bit from behind.
Pitzel, number 9, controls it. And you can see the man up there. Each team, 1 out of 4 in man up. So
neither team really able to fully capitalize on man up. BYU's thrown the ball out of bounds a few times. UMD's taken some ill-advised shots, but still 25% is not terrible if you're an offensive coach.
Prokop going against Preston Folger, and he gets double teamed there.
This is where they score, watch out.
And Jordan Harris comes up with it, gets it to Kikumoto.
Look
Kikumoto
this,
loses
this,
it, he's out of the cage.
I love the unsettled.
And the ball is still loose in front. Britton Cohn comes up with it for BYU and just motors past Chris Hutton.
And Kikumoto caught out of the cage there. Not the best pass in the world to him. I think he
did.
I think Kikumoto did the right thing there, not trying to contest two UMD players and just get back in the cage. UMD just failed to convert on that opportunity.
And Britton Cohn brings it up, tries to find higher across the field and throws it out of bounds. So BYU once again with another turnover.
Every goal here so important. I don't get the sense that the score is going to be very different than what we have at the end. Maybe a couple more goals in it for each team, but every goal just enormous at this point.
Which you know, in turn means every possession is enormous.
Nesser tries to get it up to Prokop. Ball is down on the end line, and Mattoon steps on the. Looks like Mattoon steps on the line. It's going to go back to BYU. So another good ride for BYU.
Looks like both teams back to even strength here.
And Jordan Harris says, let's settle it down. Let's bring it up. UMD tries to drop their attackmen back in the ride. They drop their middies back behind the midfield line. And Zach Davis gets it, Pitzel. I mean, it's almost giving the BYU middies the opportunity to clear that ball when they drop their midfielders back past the midfield line, but.
Well, UMD may not be going too deep in their roster. They seem to be preserving themselves a little bit on the ride, taking the play off maybe a little bit at the midline. It's a dangerous play, but they've got to conserve their energy at this point, especially at altitude.
Well, and that's a coaching decision, and you know, it might be a smart decision tactically. You let BYU get tired out. You try and keep the ball on offense as much as you can. You run when you have the opportunity, and you wait for the last couple minutes as the underdog to put your best guys back out on the field and try and pull the score even.
So with 10 minutes here, we've got BYU leading 7-6. BYU's first midfield line, Nagley, Austin, and Tyler Monteith on. Austin dodges to the right, and there's going to be a flag there. And that check rarely works.
I'm not a fan of the ice pick. The ice pick, it looks spectacular when it works, but
it's a 1 out of 10
like
deal.
More often than not, you get the push from behind call, you get the hold call. And if it doesn't work, you're in the penalty box. I don't like the check.
Well, Coach Lamb will tell you over and over again, defense is played with your feet and your hands. Your feet and your hands. It's not the fancy checks. It's being in the right position, having your footwork right. That's what stops the shots.
You can see Tiff Austin there, the wife of Josh Austin, and good to see marital support is always helpful for success on the lacrosse field.
Seems like an eternity that BYU has been on offense, and they've been giving the ball away on turnovers. Let's see.
Farron, oh, big save, Lonert. That was a nice shot by Farron, and a big save by Lonert.
Big save.
Zeebo coming the other way for Duluth. The big stick tries to run over Monteith. Probably not the wisest choice. Not that he couldn't run over him, it's just loses the ball. And now here goes Brandon Cohn the other way. He'll shoot it. But looks, oh, beautiful look. And here goes Josh Austin.
Hanging his stick.
Drug his stick.
Hanging his stick.
And Heyer comes up with a little one-handed grab. Let's see if they settle it down.
BYU needs to possess
here. And there, you must have heard you there, Glenn.
You know, you get those unsettled situations, and guys get the itching fingers to pull the trigger. But, you know, the ball's been up and down the field. We saw it against CSU. Sometimes you just need to pull it out, especially one goal up in the fourth quarter.
Paul Davis going against Fleck, and what are they calling here?
It looks like
something
crease.
Is against BYU.
In the crease.
And Josh Austin doesn't like it.
Here's
doesn't
that
like
save.
It.
And there's that unconventional style that I'm talking about. He doesn't step at the ball. He kicks his legs out sideways, just like a hockey goalie would, drops his stick to the middle, and that style's working for him today.
Okay,
saves
so
are even on the day, 7-7 for both teams. You know, this game is just turning into an even match back and forth.
I guess it looks like Minnesota Duluth was offsides on that play. I didn't see it, but BYU's going to be man up for 30 seconds.
Boy, Josh Austin was upset about something.
Yeah, he was...
But that had nothing to do with the call.
Well, I think the original call was going to be in the crease. I don't think he was happy about that, but, you know, I think
offsides.
The other ref came over and overrid the call with an offside.
Yeah, that superseded the in the crease.
Now, if BYU had the possession, shouldn't that offsides be man up right now?
They are man up.
I think it is.
They are.
They are.
Okay.
Now, this is an old play they were running in the fall.
The old hide the ball trick.
The hide the ball trick. And, boy, once again.
Turnover. Come on. And Duluth is too tenacious to do that against.
And it's going back to BYU. So fortunate in that situation to get the ball back.
Boy, what a tough defensive game. BYU is doing a real good job of shooting themselves in the foot over and over again.
Austin finds Mark Davis. Austin back up to Monteith. Man coming down. They try to find Heyer over there on the left. Can't handle it. Monteith picks up the ground ball.
And now we're all even. And BYU chewing up the clock here, but not looking sharp.
They're going to bring Heyer off, get Negley on. And they're going to settle it down. 7:53 left here in the game.
You know, BYU had this against CSU.